Hey there, gamers! This is George from the Land of Obscusion, and you're watching a special video version of my interview with Robert Grebe, who was president and CEO of American Laser Games. For those who are not familiar with the company, ALG was an arcade game developer that made FMV, or full-motion video games. Now you might be wondering, why do an interview about American Laser Games? Well, American Laser Games was the company that started the FMV genre's heyday during the 90s, yet there is little information about the company itself and the people behind it. I hope that, through this interview, some new context will be made available about this company and what they contributed to a genre that has seen a minor revival lately via titles like Her Story, Contradiction, and Tesla Effect. So, without further ado, here is the interview. Could you just introduce yourself and what exactly you did at ALG and what you're doing now?
Well, my name is Robert Grebe, and I am currently the CEO of a startup company called Traders TV, and Traders TV is a marketplace, an online marketplace, where we bring the best instructors in the world together with students who want to learn how to trade Forex currencies. Previously, I was the CEO and president of American Laser Games. That was a company that started back in the early 90s, and it actually grew up from another company that I started that created a firearms training system for police departments in the military. That we started, I want to say, in about 1989 or so.
Did the FMV games of the 80s, like Dragon's Lair, Cliffhanger, Vegas Battle, did they influence the company in any way, or was that just coincidental?
Yeah, I think it was pretty much coincidental. You know, we were out here in New Mexico, and pretty much the only game company in this part of the country. You know, we have companies out in California, but, you know, we were pretty much did our own thing and enjoyed some success with it for a while.
What exactly led to Mad Dog McCree being the debut title for ALG?
Well, because we're in the heart of the West, and it seemed to make sense to start out with a Western cowboy theme, and that was supported by the fact that there is a fairly well-used motion picture set that exists about 40 miles north of Albuquerque, which is very accessible, and so it made it kind of a no-brainer to go in that direction.
Who Shot Johnny Rock, that featured some interesting changes to the usual formula for a rail shooter. You had removed the health and the infinite ammo, and you replaced it with a money system so you could pay the doctor to heal you. You also had to buy ammo for your Tommy gun, which itself was a change from the usual reloadable gun of that genre. Were these like an experiment in gameplay, or were they just chosen to match the 1920s motif?
Well, a little of both. You know, I think that, you know, we early on began to recognize some of the limitations in gameplay that we faced in producing this type of product. And so we were, tried with each successive game to, you know, introduce some additional gameplay and, you know, make it a little more interesting. And to the extent that it could match the theme of the game, so much the better.
Yeah, pretty much almost every American Laser Games title came off as kind of campy, as if it was meant to be like the game equivalent to a silly B-movie. And probably the best example of that is with Space Pirates. Did you and ALG aim to be campy, or was that just a side effect of the FMV genre in general?
I don't know that we necessarily aimed to be campy. Certainly that term, I don't recall ever coming up. But, you know, I think that we did strive to introduce, some level of humor, you know, into the games. And, you know, to a large degree, that came across as campy, and, you know, that's just the way it was. But to some degree, it was not largely scripted in that way. It was just stuff that we would on set come up with and, you know, decide to, make into the game.
Okay, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I enjoy that kind of entertainment in general. Just some people always look at that and they kind of wonder if you're trying to be serious, so.
Nah. It was a game.
I thought so. Mad Dog 2, The Lost Gold, that was the third and last ALG title to feature the actor Ben Zeller. He was the prospector in Mad Dog 1 and Parallax, I believe his name was, in Space Pirates. Was there any reason for the repeated use of Zeller?
Great actor and great guy. And local. Many times we had to, you know, reach out to the L.A. market and bring in actors from there. But, you know, Ben was lived right here in the community and was just a, you know, wonderful person and a, you know, and a great actor.
How in the world did Gallagher's Gallery come about?
Just a bad idea. You know, at that time, he was perhaps at the height of his career. I had caught, you know, some of his shows and, you know, thought he was pretty funny. So we decided that it might make an interesting game, just something a little bit out of the ordinary. So we reached out to him, and he was going to be in Albuquerque for a show. So he said, sure, he would participate. And he pretty much turned out to be a total prima donna. And it was just a pain in the ass to work with. And we ended up selling, I think, 10 of those games. I mean, it was a total flop.
It is obvious that the budget for each ALG game was progressively larger than the last, and right. The Crime Patrol games, like the sequel Drug Wars, had a lot more to them visually, with like special effects and stunts, than was like in the original Mad Dog. At this point, a lot of other developers were saying that their FMV games were costing like $2 to $3 million to make. Did ALG ever spend anywhere near that much to make their games?
No. You know, interestingly enough, I think we produced Mad Dog McCree, the original, for $70,000. You know, some of the subsequent games we spent a lot more, but I don't recall ever spending more than $500,000 or $600,000 for, you know, any subsequent game. So games at that time were starting to become much more expensive, not only in their production costs, but in the, you know, cost to promote them. And so, you know, that was just a transition that was occurring in the industry. But, you know, I don't think we ever spent in production and in marketing anything close to $1 million.
Okay. The Last Bounty Hunter, Fast Draw Showdown, and Shootout at All Tuscon were all filmed at the Old Tuscon Studio in Arizona. Were these, like, filmed simultaneously, or, like, one after another in sequence, or was this just a reliable location to film at?
As I recall, we shot two of them in one shoot, and we went back a year later or so and shot the third one. I think we shot Fast Draw and Shootout at Old Tuscon during the same event, but, you know, that was just a, you know, representing another movie location different from the Eves Ranch, which is what we had used for the Mad Dog series. And so it presented an opportunity just to get a little different look. And at that point, again, we, you know, were continuing to, you know, try to come up with new types of gameplay, you know, just to change things up a little bit.
Okay. Actually, speaking of Shootout at Old Tuscon, would you be able to explain the concept behind it and what made it different than the other ALG rail shooters? It was the last arcade game the company ever got out. It was given very limited release, and there's no console port even today. So there's, like, no information on it. The most video on it, on YouTube, for example, is just the opening trailer, a track mode.
Well, you know, that was, you know, a game that, you know, I don't think, you know, in many respects was so very different from any of the, you know, games that came before it. The reason why that you don't see much about it is the reason why that you don't see much of American Laser games after that period of time, which is because the, you know, the market reached a tipping point. The arcade business just basically fell off a cliff, and with it, that game and, for the most part, American Laser games.
I'm looking throughout, like, the different advertisements that you can find online, and there were three other games, like Mazer, Orb Attack, and an arcade port of the 3DO game Way of the Warrior, and I guess those just were all canceled because of you cut out the arcade industry. Do you remember if any of them actually had, like, machines made at the very least?
Well, they didn't have many, if they had any. I think we, you know, we made some 3DO products. American Laser Games was in May of 1994, was set to do a public offering and become a publicly traded company. We had a valuation of 40 to 50, and we were looking to raise around $20 million, as I recall. And the coincided with just a tipping point in the video arcade market where the gameplay and, that you saw on home consoles had been improving and just reached a point where the video game player turned to, you know, home consoles and turned away from putting coins into arcade video games, and the arcade market virtually collapsed at that point in time. And not that we had anticipated that, but we had definitely seen that the home entertainment market was growing and becoming a force, and so we had been working to develop games for the home platforms, and there really wasn't much there at the time, but we did develop for Sega, and we did some stuff for a company called Philips, and for IBM, and for 3DO, and so we were moving towards moving the, you know, the full motion video games into those platforms, but we were also looking to try to develop non-full motion video games just to, you know, be able to broaden our reach. So,
Mazer, which was on 3DO, and it was a arena shooter with digitized actors instead of FMV.
Right.
Was this always going to be the direction ALG was going towards with, like, digital actors, or was FMV going to try to stay around in some way or another?
Well, you know, we were going to ride that pony as long as we could, because it, it worked, you know, very, very well. I mean, you're up there in Jersey, back in the heyday of Mad Dog, it was bringing in $3,500 a week at the Jersey Shore. So, I mean, it was an extremely successful series of games for, you know, a period of time. So, operators of arcades just, they loved us. You know, we were not going to step away from that, but we were also going to, you know, look at other platforms and other styles of games to try to branch into.
In 2008, a site called Unseen64 showcased images of a 96 preview for an ALG title for the PlayStation called Shining Sword. Do you remember that, and would you be able to explain, like, what was planned for that game?
No, I guess. I mean, I exited from American Laser Games in 1996. I was asked to leave by the venture capital partners that I had at that time. So this was a game that we had in development, so it I never was around to see, you know, how well or poorly it fared.
Okay. Just on a quick aside, what brought about the creation of Her Interactive? It's kind of odd to think of a game like McKenzie & Company, which is essentially a FMV dating simulator.
Well, that was actually the brainchild of my wife, Patricia, who was our marketing director, and she was an extremely creative person, and, you know, we were always looking for new opportunities in, you know, full motion video games, and certainly at that time there was no focus on games for girls whatsoever, so we, you know, thought it presented an opportunity to, you know, put a foothold into that market, and so we created that game. You know, it enjoyed limited success, I would say.
Okay, well, the company's still around, so it was a good idea in the end, I guess. Just for a quick trivia, I guess, do you remember the last product released with the ALG logo, like, by the time you left?
The last products that we had that had any traction were, you know, the full-motion video games that, like the, you know, Fast Draw Showdown, or perhaps a Shootout at Old Tuscon. We were developing some non-full motion video games, and they were, you know, in some stage of development, and so I guess the short answer is not beyond that.
Around the same time ALG was around, there was Tom Zito's Digital Pictures, which nowadays has kind of become the poster child for FMV games of the 90s and how they're looked at nowadays. If you remember Digital Pictures, how would you say ALG differed from them?
Well, the fact of the matter is, George, I'm not familiar with their product, quite honestly.
Okay. Well, their biggest one was the game Night Trap, and that was the part of a big controversy when it came to violence in video games back in, like, the early to mid-90s. And yet, ALG's products, which were all about, like, shooting real people, in a sense, never seemed to get in trouble. Was ALG ever affected by, in any way, to that violence controversy that led to the creation of the ESRB?
Well, it was something that, you know, 20 years ago that you know, the rating of video games was really just in its infancy. It had been, you know, created by the market, as I recall, the, you know, the trade associations as a way to try to, you know, bring something similar to ratings that, you know, the movie industry is controlled by. And so it was, you know, an issue, but it wasn't really an issue for us. I mean, began to have to rate our games, and I'm not sure that anybody at that point in time necessarily paid a whole lot of attention to it. And if you compare, you know, the level of violence in our games to what they have today, it's rather kind of, it's kind of a joke. So
yeah, there's no blood or anything like that in ALG titles. Yeah. It was kind of funny because there was a video on YouTube taken from an old Today Show interview with you and someone else from ALG, and it's about Mad Dog McCree with Katie Couric playing it, and she's like having a ball.
Yeah, that was a fun day. That was with myself and Pierre Maloka, who was a gentleman that did a lot of the early software work for us, and was quite a key asset for us at that time. But we had a good time, and Mad Dog was just a hugely popular game. As a matter of fact, we ended up selling more of Mad Dog than we did all the other games put together.
Wow. What would you say is the legacy of American Laser Games after all these years?
We certainly enjoyed a tremendous popularity for, a number of years in the, VRcade business. And to that extent, we probably, justify a page or two in the annals of video game history. But I don't know that there's any real legacy beyond that.
Okay, because like what you indicated, you're almost were like your company and you guys were just like in your own little area while everyone else was doing their stuff.
Yep.
If you had a chance to relive the existence of American Laser Games, would you change anything the second time around?
The demise of American Laser Games, came from the collapse of the arcade video game market. Certainly nothing that we controlled. We were working to, produce home games. We could have probably got started on that a little earlier, but, the game business is tough. And, once we lost that leg of the arcade game, it put us on pretty tenuous footing. So in the end, we just couldn't produce, at a level of some of the big houses like Electronic Arts and Sony and Sega, who were much better financed and had, a much greater well of creative talents than what we had.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Pleasure, George.
And that's the end of the interview. Once again, I want to thank Robert Grebe for taking the time to talk with me about the history of American Laser Games, and I wish him the best in his endeavors with Traders TV. Don't forget that there is also a transcribed version of this interview on the blog as well, and you can get there via the link in the description. Thank you very much for watching.